Thanks. Hi, everybody. Melody Ko. I am head of product at Blue Apron, and thanks to BuzzFeed for hosting us. It's funny because Blue Apron actually just moved to BuzzFeed's. So what I want to talk about today is this concept, habit-forming design. And I think it's an interesting perspective from a company that has an offering that is not just digital. So I'll go into a little bit about what Blue Apron is, what we do, the things that we consider day-to-day from the broader product team, as well as the product design team specifically. And then I'll go through a case study, talk about something that we launched recently from the team about a month and a half ago, and some quick learnings, different considerations that we went into that. So 2 seconds about myself. So I run the product management team, product design team, and analytics team at Blue Apron. I've been there for about 2.5 years, being a customer of Blue Apron for about 3 years. So quick tidbits about Blue Apron. Our mission, actually before that, who here has cooked Blue Apron? Oh, wow. Yay, customers. Or previous customers, if that's the case, then we can talk afterwards about why you churn and why you might want to come back. So Blue Apron is a company, for those of you who don't know, we send fresh ingredients, exactly portioned, with recipes designed to cook delicious meals at home, like restaurant-quality dishes. And you can talk to your friends next to you who cook Blue Apron. They're delicious. Or go to Instagram, hashtag Blue Apron, and see some of the creations from our customers. But behind that, our mission is really about making incredible home cooking accessible to everybody. Incredible home cooking accessible to everybody. How do we do that? We really are achieving that through essentially building a brand new and a better food system and supply chain. I'll touch a little bit about this in the second half of the presentation. How we do that is essentially we work directly with farmers, suppliers, to really figure out what we need in exact quantities to ship to our customers. And we have a culinary team that design recipes that will utilize those ingredients. A lot of them you can access even if you go to Whole Foods today. We actually did a study looking at average Blue Apron recipes, and Whole Foods actually only has about 90% of the coverage in terms of the types of ingredients you can find. So you can't even replicate Blue Apron recipes if you really want to. So that's what we're very proud of, exposing customers to new ingredients, as well as enjoying cooking without a lot of hassle, and really making sure that they can spend a lot of time together at home with their loved ones and spend more time in the kitchen. So a little bit about our scale. I want to touch on that is because it's important to think about this as now that we are shipping over 8 million meals a month to essentially the entire continental U.S. is covered by our essentially homegrown supply chain logistics network that we put together over the years. We have 3 fulfillment centers, over 4,000 employees nationally. In New York, we have about 300. So this all means that the product team and the product design team, the stuff that we do and the things that we put out really has a large-scale impact. So we want to be very thoughtful about the digital experience that we create. So why is digital experience important? Blue Apron, at the end of the day, its most explicit product is a physical box that shows up at your door, probably maximum once a week. You open it, you have ingredients, you cook the meal. But we think about the product team's role, and the focus is really on shaping the physical habits through digital experience. A little bit about what we focus on at Blue Apron, broader product team and product design team. The mission is really about advancing Blue Apron's product offering while at the same time maintaining a cohesive vision about the user experience. The key thing here is the user experience because, again, it's not just digital. It's hybrid. One minute you're touching Blue Apron through a physical experience, the next minute you're touching a digital experience. So that really presents us with a lot of opportunities to build interesting levers to blanket you as a customer at home, touch points across your day-to-day, when you're cooking or when you're not cooking, and really have the opportunity to fundamentally change your behavior and build habits, especially because we are a subscription product. And the reason is that it's something that we want to contemplate all the time is if Blue Apron is to be successful, to really have a presence in customers' home, whether that particular week you have a delivery, or you have ingredients in your fridge, or you are thinking about cooking Blue Apron that night or not, we want to make sure that we have a persistent presence and thoughtful presence that we can gradually really help shape a behavior in a way that help Blue Apron become the fundamental day-to-day of your lifestyle. So this is a seemingly overwhelming chart, so I apologize. So what this is trying to illustrate is how we think about a user journey. Unlike, you know, a lot of people talk to me about, oh, you know, I think Blue Apron is very interesting because I love e-commerce, and you guys are like e-commerce company. We're e-commerce in the sense that we, you know, do commerce through electronic means. We eventually use internet to really connect with you and ship physical products to you. But our dynamics are extremely different from most other traditional e-commerce company. We have one single point of conversion. We drive you through the homepage, educate you about Blue Apron, and at some point you convert to become a member of the subscription program. And it's a flexible subscription in the sense that, unlike Time Magazine, you either have it on or have it off. If you have it on every single week, you get Time Magazine. Blue Apron, you have a lot of flexibility. Even if you're a customer and a subscriber, you can decide how often do you want to cook Blue Apron. You can cook once a month. You can cook once a year. You don't have to cancel your subscription in order to maintain a level of flexibility. So the key is about that circle. Every time a box shows up at someone's door, there's that truck that represents the box. Then you have to, throughout the week, thinking about what you might want to do and which recipe you want to cook first. You pull the ingredients out of your fridge, you lay them on your counter in the kitchen, and you actually start cooking. You chop, you stir fry, whatnot, put together a delicious meal, you put it on a dining table, and you engage in a dining exercise. And not dining exercise, you're eating food, delicious food with your family. So the inner circle really represents the physical touch points and opportunities that we have to speak to our customer. And by the way, we're in an extremely privileged position to actually show up in a customer's door this often and in such an intimate setting like people's dining table in the kitchen. So the outer ring represents what we think are interesting levers that we can develop. And most of these circles are present today in our digital experience. How do we build opportunities to talk to our customer and use digital experience to really help enhance and amplify the inner circle so that your physical experience is better, it's more enjoyable, you watch a how-to video so you can cook faster, you know what to do. You can access the recipes you have home, even if you don't have the physical recipe cards because they're on your fridge. And you can talk to your significant other to decide which recipe to cook. You can share photos of your dinner, your creation, with friends. So that's how we think about blanketing user with thoughtful digital experience and touch points to really help shape the behavior that is physical. So what we also want to do is to make sure that even though it seems very complicated, especially with the supply chain and operations that I've set up in the back end that enables all this, we want to make sure that we deliver elegant experience to our users. So even though a lot of times, even your Blue Apron customer, you can see some of this experience behind a registration wall, it all seems pretty straightforward and simple. Behind the scenes, there are tons of stuff that happens to really get you to that very simple and consolidated experience that doesn't seem complicated at all. We show you the recipes. We figure out which ones are best fit to your taste. We figure out which day is the best day to get to you, and you have granular control without being overwhelmed, essentially. But behind the scene, there is the top to bottom farm relationship, supply chain, and the warehouse, and the logistics network that we put together to really get you to that final experience. One last thing I want to call out in terms of how we think about delivering the digital experience that really help enhance physical, and a key consideration that we have, which is a fairly unique one, is that not all engagements are good for us as a business. And what I meant by that, so every single company, including BuzzFeed, we want more engagement. We want page views, we want people to come back to the site. Amazon, we want people to come back repeat visits so we can create a repeat purchase opportunity. Most other products out there, more engagements equals better business, more money, higher lifetime value. For Blue Apron, this is something that's actually very tricky for us and requires very thoughtful consideration and very deliberate design execution because we are a flexible subscription. So on the very left, this is a MADOC graph. This is not scientific. This is illustrative. On the very left, you have low engagement. So imagine you just signed up for Blue Apron. You don't literally have to touch Blue Apron digital experience at all forever. And you will live forever happy after. Every week, you have a box that shows up with recipes that are delicious. You will cook them. We will generate revenue through that experience. And that can just happen forever after. But that's not the majority of the customers that we were solving for. Most people want to have some level of control. And most people don't cook Blue Apron every single week. I'm probably one of the exceptions, but you know, I also get employee discount. So most people, so then there are key focus in the design considerations really between the area that I call engagement paradox and all this stuff on the right called mindful engagement. And what I meant by that is if you're not thoughtful about how to bring, when you bring someone back to the digital experience, what exactly do you want this person to be seeing? What exactly do you want this person to do? At the very surface level, what could happen is someone comes back to Blue Apron. All this person is going to be doing is skip a delivery because it's all by default scheduled. So it's a very scary concept because you bring someone back to the experience, all they do is damage your revenue. Well, obviously, that's not to say that we want to hide the experience, you know, very far away from user and make sure, you know, we want to make sure people have what they need. So the key focus on the consumer experience side is really about how do we get to the stuff on the right? How do we make sure that, go back to that rim, how do we make sure we use digital as a platform to really bring utility and delight to the user so that overall their holistic experience is better? And digital enforce the physical experience and reinforce each other. A lot of the stuff that we think about, for example, is about building a stronger emotional connection. You cook Blue Apron, if you're the one who's the, we call it executive chef or sous chef, there's someone in the household typically plays the role of executive chef, of being the primary chef in the kitchen. If you're that person, you bring delicious dinner onto the dining table, you're probably pretty proud. You also feel like you learned something. So there are a lot of very interesting emotions that happen throughout that process. So for example, can digital play a better role and more prominent role in amplifying that? And why is that good? Well, because then, you know, it's a positive reinforced mechanism, so then the customers are happier, they feel like getting something out of Blue Apron, more so than probably the superficial level of benefits, like, oh, it's convenient, or, you know, it gets calories in my belly. So that's something we think a lot about. So now, onto something that we recently launched, to talk through kind of in real life execution, how this actually happens. So in mid-July, so almost 2 months ago, we launched a brand new member landing experience on the web. Internally, we call it MyBA, so that's what kind of my Blue Apron, how I'm going to reference that from now on. So for people who have been a Blue Apron customer before mid-July, you probably don't even remember what you see when you first log in, because it wasn't really thoughtful. It was very static. It almost felt like it was advertisement every time you come in. So you immediately go to the place that you actually want to go to because that landing experience did not provide utility whatsoever. So how do we think about, for this particular example, how did this experience play into the earlier framework that I referenced? So the orange circles are the ones that actually this experience touched on. For example, you can access recipes at home. That seems very simple and straightforward. For the past 3.5 years, you did not have a way to very easily access that once the delivery is shipped. We have this concept called delivery schedule that show you the upcoming deliveries that you need to be aware of. But once it's shipped, it disappears from the delivery schedule. So a lot of the things that a lot of times customer will ask customer service, like, hey, how do I find the recipes I have at home? You know, we haven't been able to do that until 2 months ago. Other things, like, do you need a microplan? Because you have 3 recipes this week that requires intense zesting. For people who are Blue Apron customers, you know what I'm talking about. We love zesting and we love citrus. So if you don't have a microplan, by the way, $13 on Blue Apron Market or Amazon, it will change your life in terms of how you cook because it just saves you so much time. How-to videos. Maybe you're a newbie chef. You don't know, like, this is your second delivery. And you probably would be able to save 5 minutes if you just watch the how-to video about how to properly chop onion. And I'm serious. I hadn't watched that video for about two years, and then I watched it, I was like, oh my God, I'm missing out big time. And I told my husband to watch it because the way he chopped onion just, I don't know, some kind of craziness and non-systematic way of chopping onion, I would say. So this is really what we try to tackle, and we explicitly think about the things that we want to make sure that users need to so then they can properly live the Blue Apron lifestyle without hassle. So three major goals as we went into this project. One really is building a stronger relationship. It's no longer about just the transactional benefit, the basic things that you need to have to manage your Blue Apron delivery. Really provide access to the things they need so that they are more successful in the kitchen and they're happier. And they feel like they have what they need to able to effortlessly cook the recipes with satisfaction. And lastly, it's essentially hopefully building a platform for thoughtful engagement and eventually a more personalized experience, because it really becomes a launch pad and we get a better understanding of you over time so that we can then show you the things that are most relevant to you. This doesn't happen today, but you know, if you cook Blue Apron for 2 years, we're not going to show you how to chop onions because you most likely wouldn't know how to chop onions other than me personally, who didn't watch that video for 2.5 years until very recently. So three key design considerations that we had as we were going through the design process. The first one, I call it, stay true to its purpose. So what I meant by that is a member's landing experience is probably the most prominent real estate in our digital experience on the web. So when you start your design thinking and what should be in here, what should not be in here, it's very, very easy to get distracted. And in this particular screenshot, this is my recipe, one of my recipes this week. So what the end result was, okay, we're gonna show the hero image so you know the beautiful big image and you can see it, you know this recipe you have at home. You can prep time, cook time, quick access, the things that you might want to have quick access to decide whether you wanna cook this tonight or not. One video and one ingredient. We, early on in the design process, we went down a rabbit hole for a little bit about, well, why don't we show more? And why don't we show even more of that? Well, but that's the recipe page experience. We have a digital version of the recipe page that is very robust, has all the how-to video that's associated with that recipe, all the ingredient stories, supplier, and many, many other things. But this is not meant to replace the recipe details page. It is meant to provide you with some level of discoverability and quick access so that if you need more, you know where to go find it. So that was one consideration that we struggled with a little bit when we're in the design phase of this. The second thing was meal and wine both loved. We not only have our core business is meal. We are about making cooking incredible home cooking accessible to everybody. We last year also launched a wine pairing program. It's also part about enhancing your dining experience because these all selected wine that are specifically meant to pair with the recipes that you have at home. So the challenge here is that meal is a weekly cadence. Until then, Blue Apron is a world of weeklies. Everything is structured in weeklies. And then now wine hits. Wine is a monthly thing, also flexible. So you have all these different user states that had very different cadence, and you have to design a landing experience. We don't want to have bifurcated landing, like here's where you go for wine, here's where you go for food, but you know, it's just about integrated Blue Apron experience. So we wanted to make sure this works as well for someone who's only a meal customer, someone who's only a wine customer, with very, very different cadence and different consideration, different delivery mechanism to seamlessly work together. So building an information system that can accommodate that was an interesting challenge. Lastly, we have a right rail, we have these modules that we call What's New. So one of the desires that we had during the design process is to make sure we have a mechanism to talk to our user. Major announcements, spotlight, guest chef that we're collaborating with from Gramercy Tavern, talking about our mission, thinking, you know, telling you about the micro plan because we have Blue Apron Market as a business. So that's all very like what we want you to know as a business. It's like our business objective. But then we also need to balance it with what you want and what's useful for you. Because if we don't make this useful for you, you're not going to engage with us. So then we don't get the message across. So it was a very interesting exercise to both design the interaction mechanism as well as essentially editorial calendar that balanced those needs so that we don't go down this path of just blasting things out there that we as a business want you to know and I'm not being interesting and useful for you at all. So the key learning here, so we launched about 2 months ago. It's a little too early to have some quantitative KPI-driven results, but I want to talk through a few qualitative learnings. The most interesting thing for us, summarizing one sentence, is that if you build it with good content, they will come. I mean, this is not actually a fair statement because they have to come because it's their landing page, but people do spend time, as we know, people do spend time on this experience. Three interesting things that we found. One, recipe rating. So one of those modules that are on the right-hand rail is called recipe rating. For people who being Blue Apron customers for a while, you probably know that. You're probably like, I don't know where to go to rate recipes because I've just never seen it. And that's something that we've been keenly aware. As Blue Apron continues to develop, one of the key focus is to make sure that we understand you better so we can better personalize your experience, both from the content perspective as well as from the recipe development perspective so that we can send you things that you actually like to eat as a household. So we want to make sure more people engage with recipe ratings. So we put them, put recipe ratings in a module on the top right, along with a few other content pieces, is really just trying to get a sense of what people are actually engaging with. This was very interesting learning because this engagement of this particular module was 5 to 10x compared to all the other modules we've had, regardless of position. So our interpretation of that, and this needs to be further validated with more user study, is that people like to rate recipes because people want us to know more about them, because they think that this will result in better experience for them long term. And we actually have a lot of anecdotal feedback prior to this launch of people telling us, like, I would love to rate recipes, but I don't know how to find it. Just let me rate your recipes so that you guys can make better recipes, you know, for me later on. So this is very interesting. Even though it's not explicitly stated utility, people, customers and users derive their interpret version of their understanding of the utility and then engage with way more. Second thing, so what we saw is this is a responsive experience. It's not on native yet. What we saw is that more views on desktop, but way more engagement as a percentage of page views on mobile. So this really proved one of our hypotheses, because if you go back to that rim earlier, I'm not going to click back, a lot of the contents are going to be related to on-the-go planning, pre-cooking, or immediately post-cooking. It's useful most of the time, not during when you're in the kitchen, but when you're not in the kitchen. Throughout the week, you have three recipes in your box. Throughout the week, you think about Blue Apron in a way that probably make the most sense. So what we are getting out of this is that this really proves our hypothesis about a lot of people use mobile to do on-the-go planning. They try to figure out what they want to do with their physical experience through this digital engagement. And that really shows in this stat. Last but not least, we looked at those highlights. So under each of those recipe cards, we highlight one key how-to video and one interesting story about ingredients. And we saw how-to video engagement versus other recipe highlights had significantly more amount of interest. Overall, this is not a ginormous percentage of all users who land on the page. But still, this shows us that we could do an even better job of surfacing the discoverability of these how-to content, because people want to learn. And it also proves us that if people have what they need, they actually engage, and then they're happier. Hopefully, we'll have to validate that after with more user study to better understand whether accessing those videos and being able to learn the techniques really help enhance their physical experience. But that, at least, is our hypothesis. This is a good first step to get there. So that's it for what I had.
Thank you.
So two part of your question. Part one is the heavy use of image. We like how our food looks. Our culinary team is extremely talented, and we are very proud of our food photography. Food is a very image-driven thing. You look, so hopefully, oh, by the way, this made you all hungry. I apologize for that. It's a very thoughtful decision around which, you know, ingredients showing what page. But we love to use, really let the recipes and ingredients and food shine, because we think that's the most effective mechanism to engage with the user. And that also is a proxy for what you're about to get. So there's an explicit decision since the very early days of Blue Apron. Even if you go like way back machine, you can see heavy use of recipe images, especially. Part two of your question is about UGC. Yes, so we have been thinking a lot about that. There is a very organic section of our site that kind of emerged throughout the years. If you go to our digital recipe experience, scroll all the way to the bottom, there's a section called Tips for Home Chefs. It's a very innocent Facebook comment plugin that we put in there 3 years ago, 3.5 years ago. And over time, it grew into this very high utility thing that people check out and engage with each other. A lot of times people read that because they actually get useful tips from people who cook the recipe earlier part of the week. So that's probably something that we want to explore more in 2017, both in terms of how to really leverage a community that is very passionate to generate additional content that is going to be useful for other chefs that are cooking Blue Apron. Especially we have this unique advantage of one every single week, the whole nation cooks these 8 or 6 recipes, and they can all share their experience. So that's definitely something we're thinking about. But today, at this very moment, that's probably the only place you'll see UGC. It works. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, so the question is essentially what's Blue Apron's target audience? And you mentioned that you've seen us outside of Whole Foods. So I would say that, you know, we go back to our mission. Our mission is really make sure that celebrate cooking and help people make cooking accessible. And incredible home cooking accessible. So if you look at our actual audience today, our actual customers, we have everybody. We have people who are as young as in their 20s, as old as in their 80s, people in urban areas, obviously places like New York City, rural suburbia. We have, you know, you talked about, you know how to cook. We have a lot of, we've seen a lot of actually social interactions from people who self claim they're chefs. They're very proficient chefs, graduates from CIAs, and they love cooking Blue Apron. I think Blue Apron, an interesting thing about Blue Apron is a very experiential product. So a lot of the benefits of cooking with us really don't shine until you actually experience yourself. So for some people, it really is about, it makes cooking at home effortless. Some is about discovering unique ingredients and staying fresh, getting out of your routine of the 3 or 5 recipes you know how to make. A lot of this combination of that is just enabling you, even if you have certain barriers from cooking regularly, it really helps remove that and help you net-net spending more time in the kitchen. And you know, I think we really try to make sure that we are as accessible for people who don't know how to cook at all, like the only thing you've done is boiling eggs, or putting stuff in microwave, or to, you know, it continues to stay interesting, engaging, and fun, and delicious for people who are all the way super proficient. I've even heard stories that people who are running restaurants and doing weekends, they don't want to do their restaurant thing, they cook Blue Apron with and for their family. So the whole gamut.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you.